If you want to connect two printed parts with a screw, this is a type of zero-cost thread that you should seriously consider using. It's super easy to design into your parts, provides strength that's more than good enough for almost anything you could use it for, and it's ready to use straight off the printer. No setting inserts or cutting threads. The best part is, it's just a fancy hole, and solving problems with free geometry and free detail is something that 3D printers are really good at. I use standard machine screws like these all the time with my prints, but as good as this method is, there is no one-size-fits-all solution. In this video, I'll give you an overview of the options you have, show you the easiest ways to use them in your own designs, and then rate each one based on ease of use, strength, and durability, so that you know which option is the best choice for the kind of project that you're working on. And one of the key parts to creating reliable printed parts is keeping your filament in good shape, with today's sponsor, the Sunlu FilaDryer E2. Now, I've been using the FilaDryer S4 for a while, and it's been really versatile for drying moisture-sensitive filament before printing, or even granulates for my filament extrusion experiments. The E2 is an upgraded version that can now handle temperatures up to 110 degrees Celsius, which not only allows you to dry high-temperature materials more efficiently, but it now also supports a new part annealing mode that can drastically improve the mechanical and thermal resistance of your printed parts. High-performance materials like polycarbonate or nylons can profit a lot from a controlled, precise heat treatment, but even regular PLA can be annealed and becomes much more heat-resistant in the process. Even with the higher internal temperature, the outside of the FilaDryer E2 always stays below 60 degrees Celsius with no exposed metal parts that could burn you. Internally, the E2 features improved airflow and can fit a pair of 1 or 2 kilogram spools or a single plus-size spool up to 250 millimeters in diameter. And right now, you can get the FilaDryer E2 with a special pre-sale offer, so check out the link in the description below. We're going to start simple with the humble straight hole. This is arguably the easiest to design, but in practice, it's the hardest one to get right. Any CAD suite has a hole tool that you can plop down anywhere and then tell it what exact hole you want. The small M3 thread is my most used type of screw, and to get that to bite into an unthreaded hole requires super tight tolerances from your printer. If the hole is just slightly too large, the threads won't get enough engagement and you'll just strip it out. If the hole is too small, the screw will need to stretch out the entire printed perimeter, which makes it really tough to thread, and if you go too fast with that, you risk melting the plastic. On horizontal holes, you can even split apart the layers, so overall, I'm giving this option 2 stars for ease of use. If you get it perfect, this sort of connection can be pretty strong, but in practice, it's a coin toss every single time, and because it's not repeatable, it also gets 2 stars for strength and reliability. Would not recommend. Now, a quick note about using coarser thread screws made for plastic or wood screws. In my opinion, those are actually not a great fit for 3D prints. They have a deeper thread engagement, so they'll bury themselves deeper into the plastic, and that works for softer and thicker injection molded parts, but because we're printing with perimeters and a mostly hollow part behind that, that also means the coarser screw will cut through more of the load-bearing shell of your print. Also, these are just a lot harder to source than standard machine screws. Next, straight holes that you tap to size. Again, super easy to design. You just look up the center bore size for your thread, use the hole tool, print it, and then you use a hand tap or a machine tap to cut a perfect thread into that hole. Now, I don't have the patience to do that by hand, so I'll always use a drill, but that makes it easy to melt out the thread, especially on PLA, or when you have a deeper hole that creates a lot of shavings that you have to clear out. I printed these air filter holders in PTG. They're individual segments that are connected with a bunch of M3 screws, and even though I was using ethanol to cool everything, I still blew out about a third of the threads. But if you do get it right, you'll get a thread that makes full contact with the screw, and even though you did cut away some of the perimeter, it's still going to be a plenty strong connection that won't easily wear out over time either. If you need a stronger connection, create a longer thread for more engagement or use a bigger thread size. 3 stars for ease of use, 4 for strength, and 3 for durability. A variation of these is printed threads, but unless you're printing in resin, I find they only print well enough for sizes M6 and larger, so 1/4 inch and up. And those are just not used that often for connecting simple plastic printed parts. But at least in Fusion, model threads are super easy to add with the hole tool. In Onshape, it's not baked in, but you can use a third-party add-on to get the same functionality. Next, the new one. Let's call this one a self-forming thread. Now, I'm probably not the first one to come up with this idea, and it's a pretty logical approach. I needed something for these mid-frames of the sensor box that would require no specialized tools and would still easily print on any 3D printer. And in function, this is very similar to the straight untapped hole, but it reduces the cross-section that the screw has to deform down to just three individual ridges. Because the overall hole is a little larger than the screw, these ridges can be designed to have a larger overlap with the screw threads, because now the deformed material has somewhere to go, instead of the screw having to stretch out the entire hole. And if you print it horizontally, as long as you print one of the ridges straight down, it's gonna print just fine. This is one that I'll give 5 stars for ease of use. And because they're super predictable, they'll get 4 for strength, and lastly, 3 for durability. Here's how to add these to your parts. Of course, you could model these from scratch every time you want to use them, but it's much simpler to model the negative space, the cutout, just once, and then import that into the thing you're currently working on. I did these in Onshape, but the idea is the same in Fusion. Once you're ready to add these self-forming thread features to your actual part, you create the reference points where you want them, then use the Derive feature to import the geometry to your workspace. Onshape uses these mate connectors as references, and I found they snap to your target points best if you create a small hole first, instead of just using a sketch point. Then use the Boolean tool to subtract each of the negative space bodies from your part, and voila, that's ready to print. You can even take this a step further. For example, if you commonly use these M3x10 screws like I do, you could add the cutout geometry for the through-hole part too. So if you have a box with a lid, import it once, place it at the point where the thread needs to start, then cut the box and the lid with the same negative space part, and you're always going to have both halves made up perfectly with the right amount of thread engagement. I've linked these designs in the description below. Moving on to metal threaded inserts. Now, these of course are a different category of threads, but they definitely have their uses too. There is quite a selection here, and I've done a video where I compared a whole bunch of different inserts, and what they all do really well is to keep the threads from wearing out. On the filter box, I ended up using these self-forming threads for the connections between the segments. Those will only be tightened once, ideally. But I opted for heatset inserts for the lids, as these will need to come off every time I change or check the filters. A metal-on-metal connection is hard to beat for durability. Heatset inserts are easy to design for, as again, you just need a plain hole, but this time the tolerances are much more forgiving as you're melting the entire thing anyway. But for setting them straight and accurately, you need a good amount of patience, a soldering iron, ideally with the proper setting tips, and some people even build little linear axis guides to keep their soldering iron straight. So overall, it's quite a bit of post-processing time you have to spend on every single threaded hole you want to use. Something like these thread repair inserts are a little harder to find and less standardized, but they do provide basically the same strength as heatset inserts. And for the larger sizes like this M8, if you model their external threads into your print, they also don't disturb your printed perimeters. For absolutely maximum strength, nothing so far has beaten prong nuts. For these to fail, you'd have to tear them through your entire printed part instead of just pulling them out of a hole. But they do require that you design your part around them, as these are quite large and flared, and you'll need access to the backside of where you want your threaded hole to end up. Just like for the thread repair inserts, designing for these can be made a little easier by modeling the negative space once and then importing and cutting that out of your final part. So overall, these metal inserts all fall off for ease of use in one way or another, but they provide between very good and unbeatable strength, and their threads are basically impossible to strip or wear out. Lastly, inserted nuts. These are typically used by creating a slot at a 90-degree angle from your screw hole and then sliding them in. Hex nuts will often tilt while pushing them in or start spinning in the printed part when you're tightening them, so usually square nuts are the preferred choice here. Designing for them is fairly easy. Simply create a cutout that is a little larger than the nut itself and extend that to the nearest edge of your part. The center hole for the screw is the standard clearance size for the thread all the way through, And because this is all simple geometry, the slot will come out very usable in pretty much any print orientation. In the finished part, you then simply slide your nuts in all the way and fasten the screws through them. Now, this can be a bit finicky as there's nothing that keeps the nut aligned to the screw thread, so I'll use a small hex key to push it in, but in general, this is pretty quick and easy. 4 stars for ease of use, but I've seen plenty of parts crack in that weak spot that the added slot creates, so I can only give it 3 stars for strength. But being a metal-on-metal thread, and having the ability to easily replace the nut if you ever damage it, earns this a 5-star durability rating. I think it's great that we have all these options now, and it just makes designing functional 3D prints so much more viable. What I'll personally be using for low to medium strength applications is the self-forming threads up to like an M5 and printed threads beyond that. And for anything that needs more strength than that, either, you know, good old heatset inserts because they're so easy to do in CAD, or the thread repair inserts if you have parts with lots of threaded connections. Let me know in the comments below what is your favorite way of adding threads to a printed part. A big shout out to everyone who's supporting the channel on YouTube memberships and Patreon. Thank you all for watching, keep on making, and I'll see you in the next one.